All right. Good morning. Welcome to this edition of St. Louis History Live. I am Mark Sundlow, the Director of Soldiers Memorial. Certainly happy to help. Happy to have you here this morning, virtually anyway. And thank you for attending this morning's program, Moving Images, Photography of the Japanese American Incarceration with Professor Dr. Jasmine Alinder. Just a few comments here before we begin. Safety continues to be a top priority for us, so nearly all of our program continues to be virtual, as you are attending today. However, Soldiers Memorial is open Wednesday through Sunday, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. with several safety precautions in place, and we'd love to have you visit if you are feeling safe to do so. Today's program supports our current ongoing special temporary exhibition, Righting a Wrong, Japanese Americans in World War II, which focuses on the incarceration of Japanese Americans during that war. The exhibition will open, it will run and be open through October 3rd, so just a few more weeks. So if you haven't seen it, please come down and do so before it is gone all too soon. And thank you to those of you who are members of the Missouri Historical Society. Your support is deeply appreciated. If you are not a member and you are interested in becoming a member, I will place a link in the chat box where you'll be able to copy and paste that into your browser to get more information. Just a few quick notes on logistics. Today's program will run 30 to 40 minutes. We'll have a period of question and answers. Following that, please submit questions through the Q&A button, question and answer button, which is in your Zoom toolbar at the bottom or top of your screen. And we'll do our best to answer all the questions. However, if we run out of time, we apologize, but we will do our best to get to as many as we can. Today's presentation is being recorded. So if you'd like to view it again, or more importantly, if you'd like to share it with others who you know will find it interesting, please visit the Missouri Historical Society's YouTube channel, where you'll be able to find this program and many others that we have done over the time here. Your feedback is always important to us. We would appreciate it if you could answer a few questions at the end of the program. A Kobo toolbox survey will open in a tab in your browser, which will just ask you a few questions to help us better prepare and execute our programs here. Well, without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Jasmine Alinder. Dr. Alinder is the Dean of Humanities at UC Santa Cruz and Professor of History there. Until 2020, she was Associate Professor of History and Coordinator of Public History at the University of Wisconsin in Milwaukee. She's trained as a historian and photographer. Dr. Alinder received her PhD in art history from the University of Michigan in 1999. Since then, she has published primarily on documentary photography, including the book Moving Images, Photography in the Japanese American Incarceration, and also essays in Colors of Confinement, Rare Kodachrome Photographs of Japanese American Incarceration and World War II. So without further ado, Dr. Alinder, I'll turn it over to you. I'll stop my screen share here and you can pick up where I drop off.
Thank you so much, Mark. Good morning, everyone. It's a real honor and pleasure to be invited to speak with you today, and particularly to be introduced by Mark Sunlove, who a decade and a half ago, I recall very fondly as an excellent student in our graduate program in public history. So it's great to see your professional trajectory, Mark, and thank you so much for having me join you virtually today. So, a couple of things to start off. What I'd like to do is talk to you today about my research on photography and Japanese American incarceration. I hope for those of you who have had a chance to see Righting a Wrong, you'll see some connections. And I also want to say at the outset that there's a wonderful way that us giving these talks remotely and not together allows for greater access. I'm zooming in to you from Northern California, but I'll also apologize in advance if you hear any strange background noises because I'm in a home right now where other things are going on that are in fact not related to my my talk to you and my work more generally. It's been a strange mixing of domestic and professional lives in these Zoom spaces we've created. So I would like to start sharing my slides right now. And I will make sure that it's visible. Okay, looking good?
Looks great.
Okay, thank you. So much of my work as a scholar examines why photography is so important to the history of Japanese American incarceration. I argue that during the incarceration of Japanese Americans, photography became what I call a representational battleground. So I'd like to take you through a few examples of my research that show how images often work, not as windows on the past, but as contested forms of representation. And then at the end of my remarks, I'd like to share with you a related digital humanities project that I collaborated on, which is really targeted to K-12 students. I also want to say that I am extremely impressed with the way that local St. Louis stories have been featured in your installation of Righting a Wrong, Japanese Americans in World War II exhibition. Local history is often seen as less significant than other forms of history that speak to larger global forces and events, but so much local public history, like the experiences of St. Louis's Japanese Americans, the story of the Tanaka brothers, for example, speaks to transnational history as well. At the same time, it has a deep local resonance and I think an important link to our present. So the struggle over photography featured in nearly every aspect of the imprisonment of Japanese Americans during World War II. Initially, the camera was both a target and tool of repression. After the bombing of Pearl Harbor in 1941, the FBI conducted raids and many Japanese Americans destroyed artifacts, including family photographs that might have been construed as evidence of a link to Japan. So this image shows you an FBI agent as he conducts such a raid and he is examining the family's photo album. The military criminalized Japanese Americans through identity photographs and prohibited cameras in the concentration camps. The government classified the camera as a weapon of war in the same category as guns, bombs, and ammunition. So on the image on the left, you see the regulation disallowing Japanese American possession of a number of items ranging from firearms to shortwave radios to cameras. The image on the right depicts the surrendering of cameras and radios in Seattle. Images were used to designate Japanese Americans as incarcerable and unworthy of the rights of citizenship, like the mugshot you see on the left. But in March of 1942, the War Relocation Authority, formed by executive order, a civilian agency, took over the administration of the incarceration from the military. The WRA mobilized photography to publicize and record the work of the government agency and the conformity of those incarcerated to the government's orders. The task of the camera in this new context was to portray the incarceration process as efficient, humane, and orderly, as exemplified by the photograph you see on the right. This shift in emphasis towards efficiency and order may seem surprising given the WRA's function as jailers, but this strategy was in full accord with the agency's mission, which included the facilitation of the re-assimilation of the evacuees into the normal currents of American life. The architects of the incarceration, however, had made the case that Japanese Americans were the incorrigible enemy. Whether a Japanese person was a US citizen or not was irrelevant, as the purported racial characteristics of the Japanese were seen to override all other affiliations. DeWitt's position was neatly signed up by the infamous syllogism quoted in the slide. Despite his racist views, however, DeWitt had wavered in his opinion about whether Japanese Americans should be incarcerated en masse. Influenced by Major Carl Bendetsen, you see on the right, who was soon after promoted to colonel, DeWitt began to support the incarceration by January of 1942. All three of the quotations on the slide including the one at the bottom by Assistant Secretary of War McCloy, who said, quote, if it's a question of safety, the safety of the country and the Constitution, why the Constitution is just a scrap of paper to me, end quote. All three show how fragile the guarantees of the Constitution were, given that 2/3 of the Japanese Americans incarcerated were US citizens by birth. Viciously racist representations were commonplace in the popular press. Here's an example, a cartoon published in February 1942 by Theodore Geisel, otherwise known as Dr. Seuss, in which a homogeneous mass of smiling men line up to grab their boxes of TNT from a shop called Honorable Fifth Column. As a columnist in the Los Angeles Times wrote, quote, a viper is nonetheless a viper wherever the egg is hatched. So a Japanese American born of Japanese parents, notwithstanding his nominal brand of accidental citizenship, grows up to be a Japanese, not an American, and himself is a potential and menacing danger to our country, end quote. The WRA wanted to use photography to reverse damage done by previous representations like these that conflated Japanese Americans with the enemy. According to a 1942 WRA publication, its goals included, quote, to reestablish the evacuated people as a productive segment of the American population, to provide as nearly as wartime exigencies permit an equitable substitute for the lives and homes given up, and to facilitate the reassimilation of the evacuees into the normal currents of American life, unquote. So the WRA took on this contradictory representational task, portraying Japanese Americans as productive, loyal citizens, while at the same time condoning their imprisonment. The WRA's representation of Japanese Americans as fit for participation in American civic life, as deserving of the existence outside of unexistence outside of the concentration camps, hinged implicitly on its opposite pole, the purportedly dangerous, disloyal Japanese American. Throughout the incarceration, the camera created and reinforced the stark terms that separated Japanese Americans into these two mutually constituted categories, the loyal citizen and the disloyal enemy. Photography served as a kind of visual gatekeeper as photographs became integral to the articulation of the boundaries that divided those who were deemed to fit into the body politic and those who were excluded. Photographer Dorothea Lange was hired along with other photographers by the War Relocation Authority to produce thousands of images. But instead of focusing on smiling faces like we saw in the previous photograph, Lange went out of her way to embed critique of the government policy into her government-sponsored images. Most of her photographs were censored during the war. Lange's well known for her documentary photographs of the Great Depression, most notably Migrant Mother from 1936, which you see on the left. In addition to emphasizing pathos through forlorn facial expression, Lange also used the strategy of embedding commentary into her images by photographing signs. So on the right, you can see how she sets up irony as the viewer is forced to contrast destitute families camping under a billboard that reads, "Travel while you sleep." The caption reads, billboard along US 99 behind which three destitute families are camping, Kern County, California, November 1938. Lange used these same visual techniques in her WRA photographs. This photograph, which Lange made in Oakland, California in April 1942, was captioned, quote, following evacuation orders, the store at 13th and Franklin Streets was closed. The owner, a University of California graduate of Japanese descent, placed the I am an American sign on the store on December 8th, the day after Pearl Harbor. I'd like us to take a close look at this photograph to get a better sense of how Lange embedded her images with layers of meaning. So the sign placed by the owner, I am an American, coexists with other signs on the storefront. the store's name, Grocery Wanteau, which is also reiterated in the windows, its offering of fruits and vegetables, and above them all, at the top, a very large realty sign that reads sold. The sign expresses a distressing trajectory from business owner to suspect to deportee. The sold sign overrides those below it and transforms the plea, I am an American, into a poignant artifact of a failed attempt to preserve the business. For no expression of loyalty was sufficient to avoid a process of incarceration based on race rather than an individual's actual politics. In addition to these central elements, other more subtle displays of signs add layers of meaning. The building surface also reveals a torn poster, an advertisement for Philip Morris, a row of Japanese characters that read East Bay Merchant Company, and a poster of a person by the store's entrance. In the front of the store sits a car, a mailbox, and an electricity pole. To the left of the building, the viewer is led around the corner to other buildings with other cars parked out front. Sandwiched in between the pole and the row of Japanese characters, you can see the detail on the left, is a US flag, which flies atop a multi-storied building. In the flattened space of the photograph, the flag flies next to the row of characters, thus linking the iconic symbols of the United States and Japan, flag and characters, to their indexical expression in the lettered signs on the front of the building. I am an American, Grocery Wanteau. This remarkable feat of juxtaposition points to the juncture of the Japanese and the American, while the sold sign seems to question whether that nexus of identity can be sustained. Although official photographers such as Lang produced thousands of images, mostly black and white, vernacular everyday images of life made by people who were incarcerated are rare because cameras were forbidden. Occasional snapshots and some home movies exist. And once Japanese American soldiers returned to their families behind barbed wire while on furlough, they often brought cameras with them. Manzanar in Southern California provides another exception with the opening of a photography studio run by Toyo Miyataki, a professional photographer from Los Angeles, and most of the camps also produced newspapers and school yearbooks that were photographically illustrated. So given the prohibition on cameras, I was surprised when legal scholar Eric Muller sent me a link to an online gallery of color photographs, snapshots, made inside Heart Mountain, Wyoming. The photographer, Bill Manbo, was an amateur, a hobbyist, and his experience in Heart Mountain became framed through his camera's lens. The images came from the basement of Bill Manbo's son, Billy, and are the largest cache of color photographs of the incarceration that we currently know of. How did Manbo get access to his camera? The answer to this question came in documents located in the National Archives, which reveal how WRA officials debated the contraband status of the camera. Some believed that incarcerated citizens should have access to their cameras as long as they were imprisoned outside of the Western Defense Command. In a letter dated October 26, 1942, to WRA Director Dylan Meyer, WRA Regional Director Joseph Smart dismissed the fear that Japanese Americans would use cameras to photograph, quote, military objectives. Smart reasoned that Japanese Americans should have the right to create a photographic record of their lives, quote, particularly to record the lives of their youngsters in an informal fashion, end quote. So Smart here is arguing for the right to the family snapshot. Bill Manbo often focused his lens lovingly on his own son, Billy. The photographs of Billy have all the poignancy of any photograph of youth lost to time and attest to the childhood that Bill carved out for his son. A document in the Manzanar archives at UCLA tells the story of a young Nisei mother who lamented her lack of access to a camera while she was incarcerated because she could not document the growth of her only daughter. Manzanar was inside the Western Defense Command, so the access that Bill Manbo had to cameras did not extend to this Nisei mother. She writes, quote, "Here our children are getting older day by day. And once their childhood is gone, nothing on this earth can bring it back. And if we have no mementos of their growth, we feel cheated and a little bitter to think that just a snapshot now and then, even if it was taken in a concentration camp, is better than nothing at all," end quote. Most Japanese Americans have a large gap in their family albums from World War II. Bill Manbo's photographs allow us to repopulate those pages with family portraits, children playing, and other scenes of daily life, and recognize the significance that photographs play in everyday acts of self-representation. Discussions of photography and rights most often focus on images that contain documentary evidence of crimes, death, or torture. But during the incarceration of Japanese Americans, again, two-thirds of whom were US citizens by birth, the denial of the camera was part of the eclipsing of a wide range of rights, some constitutional, imprisonment without due process, and others that were part of a more informal array of rights that included the right to representation, cameras as contraband. The argument to restore the right to photography was not embedded primarily in a wish to document the suffering that the imprisonment caused, but rather in the wish to document daily events that continued in spite of the imprisonment. And through the vernacular photograph or the everyday photograph, reclaim a piece of the rights of citizenship. The very ordinariness of the practice of photographing a young boy at play signifies how essential these kinds of everyday snapshots are for constructing a normal sense of self. In this Mambo photograph, dancers' arms spread like wings with fingertips outstretched and palms facing down. The dancers keep time as they move in a circle, one foot forward, while their eyes gaze at the ground. The colors of the dancers' costumes are vibrant. One woman wears a beautiful kimono belted in red. And here's the same image with a detail on the right. A man to her left is decked out in empty food containers, accented with chaotic paper ruffles and front plates of cardboard armor that's fashioned from Rice Krispies boxes. Their joyous motion contrasts sharply with the drab barrack backdrop, where the thin lines of wood run vertically, breaking up the tar paper into repeating black bands. Regularity, sparseness, and imprisonment may mark the setting, but celebration, color, and life mark the participants. Families who had been identified by numbers, whose Americanness and citizenship were trumped by ancestry, rejoice here in a ceremony of ancestral remembrance. In this Mambo photograph of Bonadori during the Festival of Obon, the coexistence of the Japanese and the American is perhaps best expressed in the cereal boxes that adorn a dancer's costume and express a kind of cultural integration that denies the assumption that Japanese and American were mutually exclusive categories. As David Yu writes, quote, "In their day-to-day lives, Nisei, or second generation Japanese Americans, moved between many spheres and occupied multiple identities. Hence, it makes little sense to argue for an authentic self that somehow was either Japanese or American. The more compelling question," he asks, "is to ask how Nisei negotiated the complexities of identity formation in the toss and tumble of their times," end quote. In the toss and tumble of his time at Heart Mountain, Mambo used his camera to construct family and community and to make sense of a world in which his autonomy and citizenship rights had been denied. More recently, my scholarship has moved to consider the period known as resettlement, as thousands of Japanese Americans left camp for new homes, often in the Midwest, including in St. Louis. A memo from the WRA field office in Kansas City from July 15, 1944, reported, quote, "St. Louis seems to be a fine place for professional people. Already 12 doctors, 2 social workers, several nurses, a lawyer and a dentist have successfully relocated here. Although there are about 375 evacuees in St. Louis in a wide variety of occupations," end quote. One such evacuee, Sammy, who had resettled in St. Louis, wrote back to her friend Yuri, still imprisoned in Colorado. On January 16th, 1944, she talked of her impressions of St. Louis. Here's what she wrote, quote, "We rarely see a bright sunny day with clear blue skies, beautiful soft clouds, and tingly air as we used to at home. St. Louis is usually covered with a blanket of smoke, smog, or just plain dust. Right now, the view outside is that of a hazy, smoky picture. Gosh, I sound depressed, don't I? It's probably due to a combination of nostalgia and fatigue," end quote. After another paragraph, which she's also complaining, she writes, quote, "Well, don't let my above description of St. Louis air discourage your relocation plans. I think that I didn't do St. Louis justice in my letters to friends. St. Louis is probably one of the nicest places for relocation," end quote. In my research on resettlement, I examined photography illustrated pamphlets and argue that Japanese American mobility out of camp was contingent on immobility, as the US government compelled them to prove their loyalty and patriotism to the nation through confinement. As the camps were dismantled, the government initially forbade Japanese Americans from returning to the West Coast and instead created a network of resettlement offices to encourage their dispersal throughout the Midwest and East Coast. Photographs published in books and pamphlets became tools to persuade Americans outside of the concentration camps that Japanese Americans could be rewoven into the body politic and to assure Japanese Americans that better lives awaited them on the outside. One book, or really a booklet, entitled Outcast, which you see the cover of on the left, published by the Fellowship of Reconciliation, quoted the words of a child imprisoned in the US who said, quote, "Mother, I don't like Japan. Let's go back to America," end quote. His words point to the incongruities produced by the incarceration. Geographically stable citizens became immobile prisoners and then migrants in their own homeland. For both the imprisoners and the imprisoned, those incongruities blurred the categories of domestic and foreign. The child registered the domestic as foreign. In fact, he was imprisoned in the United States. He wasn't in Japan. As if life behind barbed wire were discordant with American ideals. The US government also registered the domestic as foreign by allowing Asian ancestry to cancel out birthright citizenship. While the child located the foreign in geographic space, an issue that could be solved through migration, let's go back to America, the US located foreignness in Japanese American bodies, or as Hearst columnist Henry McLemore opined in 1942, in their very blood. Japanese Americans faced the real possibility of perpetual foreign status, a position that geographic migration could not reconcile, but that representational rebranding through photography potentially could. Another booklet entitled Relocation of Japanese Americans, published by the WRA in 1943, had the same target audience of outcasts, the same goal of making Japanese Americans palatable to Americans outside camp. And this is the opening photograph of that booklet, which I found in the National Archives. And it visualizes the process of Americanization through incarceration with this picture of a young woman at work. Dressed in a broad lapelled sports coat with a wide collared plaid shirt peeking out, hair curled and pulled back behind her ears, this woman stares down at the object of her task. She appears to be trimming loose thread from a large piece of fabric, the US flag. The photograph invokes the historical trope of Betsy Ross to suggest that this Japanese American woman, by sewing the flag, contributes to the crafting of the very fabric of democracy. The woman, almost certainly an American citizen by birth, sews the icon of liberty while imprisoned because of her ancestry. Stripped of constitutional protections, Nisei had to forgo their rights as Americans in order to prove their loyalty as Americans. For Nisei, the contradiction sewn into the stars and stripes must have been all too clear. Historian Roger Daniels calls the incarceration of Japanese Americans, quote, "a link in the chain of racism that stretched back to the earliest contact between Asians and whites on American soil," end quote. That chain, unfortunately, has extended into the 21st century. As the history of Japanese American incarceration resonates with contemporary political discourse that frames certain groups as dangerous, disloyal, and somehow incompatible with the body politic. And as we've seen over the past year, an unfortunate resurgence of anti-Asian and anti-Asian American violence, the organization Stop Asian American Pacific Islander Hate released a press statement in February citing over 2,800 documented cases of racist harassment between March and December 2020. There are also frequent reminders of what May Nye refers to as, quote, alien citizenship, which also seems to continue to shape Asian American experience. The US remains haunted by this legacy of racial exclusion, deeply rooted in the nation's past and threatening to take new forms in its present. I'd like to conclude my talk by introducing you to one of the related public history projects I've been deeply involved with. I serve as the lead academic advisor and content curator for a project called The Orange Story. It's the first installment of a larger project called Japanese American World War II Confinement, a cinematic digital history project. I began working with filmmakers and web designers in 2015 to combine original scripted historically based fiction film with historically grounded archival content in a seamless online experience. And I will try to see if I can play the trailer of the film for you.
Along the entire Pacific coast, some 120,000 enemy aliens and American-born Japanese are preparing to...
As a lead content curator, I've worked closely with a larger team and guided a group of students to research, develop, and curate four chapters of archival documents, images, oral histories, and videos that provide historical context for the themes raised in the film. Each chapter is akin to an online exhibition and consists of buckets of curated content with interstitial quotes and GIFs. It's funded by the National Park Service's Japanese American Confinement Sites Grant. The project seeks to leverage the emotional power of historically based fiction film to engage audiences, particularly high school and college students who might not be familiar with this history. In this project, we're including documentary photographs in the curated buckets of archival materials, and some photographs, particularly those by Dorothea Lange, influenced the vantage point of the director while shooting the film. We're currently working on a third segment of the story, which takes place in Chicago. So I'm going to stop my screen share, and I'd like to close with that. So thank you so much to the Soldiers Memorial and to the Missouri Historical Society, and I'm happy to take any questions if there are any.
Thank you, Dr. Alinder. Really informative and wonderful presentation. Any of you who have questions, please place them in the you type them into the Q&A box on your toolbar. I know I have one question to maybe get us started a little bit. I was curious as that my understanding is that the War Relocation Authority was given instructions when taking photos of the camps that they were intentionally to avoid any capturing of the guard towers or the fences or the barbed wire. Do I have that correct, Dr. Alinder?
Yes. Yeah. So I think, you know, in an earlier in the Farm Security Administration, so during the Great Depression, the person who ran the sort of photographic side of that Dorothea Lange worked for was a man named Roy Stryker, and he gave very, very directed photo scripts, like concrete, very specific directions of what he wanted captured in the photographs. For the War Relocation Authority, there was certainly like centralization of the photographic project. All the images were funneled to one place, and caption writers would write captions that they felt like pointed to the attributes in the photograph that they wanted to call attention to and not to others. But there were general directions to make sure that the photographs did not, in fact, went out of their way to make it look more like Japanese Americans were happy, compliant, and that the WRA was not functioning as jailers. So in the camps themselves, that would mean really trying to avoid any of the, you know, barbed wire, the guard towers, soldiers with guns, things like that.
Is there photography? I know there were at least a couple, but I'm not a deep historian on this as you are, but I know that there were at least a couple of riots within the camps among those who were not compliant, who did not want to, were not willingly going along with this. Are there any photographs of those events?
Not really. I mean, there's very, very few images that speak to that kind of dissent inside camp. If anyone out there has them, I would love to see them. Let me know. I mean, even the photographs, you know, by Bill Manbo inside Heart Mountain, and there was certainly quite a bit of dissent and draft resisting inside Heart Mountain. His camera, you know, it's essentially returned to him and to others, other Nisei, under the condition that they're in fact going to be using the camera to document daily life. And by daily life, it's, you know, focusing on his son. He focused on, you know, other kinds of cultural events inside camp, you know, parades, things that you know, kind of everyday occurrences. I will say in Manzanar, once Toyo Miyataki had a little bit more freedom to photograph, and they were making images for the high school yearbooks, there's a really interesting sequence in the second high school yearbook in Manzanar. I think it's the 1945 valediction, and there's one image on one side of a barbed wire fence with a guard tower and someone holding a pair of wire cutters to the wire. And then the image next to it is of a young Japanese American couple, presumably high school seniors, dressed up really beautifully with suitcases in hand, and they're walking out of camp. And so within the yearbook itself, you know, it's two other Japanese American audiences. This was a representation of the liberation from camp as something that Japanese Americans were taking on themselves. And it's hard to imagine, you know, cutting through barbed wire being allowed by the War Relocation Authority, but inside camp, inside this, you know, high school yearbook, it was a different place to, I guess, express a kind of agency in regard to getting out of camp and that kind of liberation.
We have one question about, pull this up here, as far as the technical aspect, I guess, of the photography was, maybe specifically the Manbo photographs, how were those, do we know how those photographs were processed? And
that's a really good question. They must have been sent out to the town. I could go back and Eric Muller might have addressed that in his essay in the Colors of Confinement book. All of the images came to us as Kodachrome slides. So obviously he's not doing that himself. In Manzanar, Toyo Miyataki, originally the control over the kinds of images, I mean, he was taking images as a, you know, kind of photo studio in camp, was the control was really extreme. So initially the lens that would be fitted on the camera in the studio would be, he'd have to have, you know, basically white chaperones in the studio with him. They would remove the camera. At the end of the day, they would lock it up, or the lens, they would lock it up, and then, you know, the next day, put it back in. So they set up a dark room inside Manzanar, but I think for a lot of the other camps, and Manzanar was also in the Western Defense Command, so, you know, more tightly kind of controlled than maybe Wyoming, Heart Mountain would have been.
Interesting. And then a follow-up to that, but I think you answered this, that there was certainly a level of censorship on those photographs.
Yeah, absolutely. So Dorothea Lange, for example, you know, most of her photographs of the incarceration were censored. I mean, she was working for the government, and the government decided they were not the kind of representation that they wanted out there. So most of them were censored at the time.
A lot of these things, I try to put myself in that situation, and I'm just thinking about how prevalent cameras and photography is in our daily lives. And you know, that we carry one around with us in all of our pockets and on our phones, and how you had mentioned that we use photographs to identify and define so much of ourselves, and to have that stripped away is really, you know, thought-provoking, and what that would mean in my personal life to not be able to take any photographs of my daily activities, especially having young children, as you had mentioned, and not being able to photograph the youngest years of your children's lives, and having that stripped away is in itself a really traumatic event, I would say. But anyway,
yeah, I think commentary. I agree with you, and that's sort of part of the argument that I'm trying to make, that I think we take for granted our access to photography and how the camera functions for us continuing, you know, today. Most of us are taking pictures with our phones, but those images become really important ways to describe and articulate and share a sense of self and your connection to your family, to, you know, record how our family's lives are changing, how kids are growing up. And so when I found that quotation that I read from the Nisei mother lamenting her lack of access to a camera, that was, you know, going through stacks and stacks of archival documents actually at UCLA. And this was exactly the kind of document I was looking for, but there was nothing in the, you know, in the metadata or in the finding aids to lead me to it. And so when I found it, I felt like, you know, it was so heart-wrenching for me. And it you know, felt like this voice from the past that was reaching out. I had a young child at the time too. And so, it was something that I could really connect with and identify with. And it made me think about how important taking away the camera is, just in terms of one's own sense of self and the way that we like to create family identity.
Yeah. I'm not seeing any more questions. I certainly want to thank you for the presentation, all the time that you've taken, and your continued work on this incredibly important topic. You know, I think, it's funny, you know, our short time together when I was a student in grad school, I think I had heard about this historic event, maybe knew a little bit about it, but not really. And I was a graduate student at the time with a bachelor's in history, and knew very little about this event, but in a deep way, you know, but very, very little. And I think, so you more or less introduced me to this incredibly important topic, and the idea that American citizens can be stripped of their constitutional rights in a matter of weeks or months is really an astonishing lesson and incredibly important. And so I just want to thank you for all the work that you've done in both researching but also sharing this history, making sure that it's becoming more widely known.
Well, thank you, Mark. And thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to talk with you all this morning.
Thank you. Before we leave, I have a couple of things. I'm going to share my screen here, maybe. A couple of our upcoming programs. Tomorrow afternoon at noon, we'll be doing our kind of our monthly lunch discussion. Tomorrow we'll be with Staff Sergeant Joshua Eckhoff, who was in the United States Army. Joshua was in the war in Iraq and severely injured, and gratefully survived. And he'll be, as we reflect upon 20 years following 9/11, Sergeant Eckhoff will be sharing some of his experiences and thoughts and reflections, both upon his service, but also upon that larger 9/11 story, which was a spur for him to become engaged in the U.S. military. And then next Tuesday, we continue these series of programs from Righting a Wrong. This will be on Tuesday, September 14th at 11 a.m., Life Behind Barbed Wire. In June, Achoki Burke, who was born in Los Angeles, she was 10 years old when the exclusion orders came out in 1942, and she and her family were removed first to the Santa Anita Assembly Center and then to the Roar incarceration camp in Arkansas. And she will recount her experiences as a young child in that in those camps. But then again, please come and visit the exhibit as well. So that's all I have. I want to thank Dr. Alinder for joining us, and thank all of you for taking some time out of your day to join us. And again, this will be on our Missouri Historical Society YouTube channel. So if you're looking to share it with others, that'll be a perfect way to do that. So thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of your days.